Blog Talk Radio.
This is our Sandy Hook special. It is Tuesday, May 6, 2014. Tonight I will be interviewing actually what turns out to be one person. My guest tonight is Dave Gahary, who works for the American Free Press, whose website is americanfreepress.net. We were going to be joined by Dr. James Fetzer and Wolfgang Halbig, but they are unable to be with us tonight. And so I will just be interviewing Dave Gahary about the circumstances and what occurred today in Newtown. He was with these two gentlemen since last night, Dr. James Fetzer and Wolfgang Halbig. He was with them the entire time. And anyway, I'm waiting for Dave to call in. Dave, are you there? No, Dave. Okay. Maybe just interview myself, and I wasn't there. Anyway, they went to Dr. James Fetzer, and Wolfgang went to Newtown in order to ask the 16 questions. And anyway, they went to several places. And were inquiring about what, they're trying to find answers to Wolfgang's 16 questions. I'm not sure what occurred, and hopefully Dave will be with us shortly. He said that I just talked to him, and he said that he would be calling in. And so hopefully that will occur momentarily because I, as I said, I wasn't there, so I have no idea what did happen. And anyway, I'm not seeing Dave or hearing from him at all, so I don't know what to think here. I'm not sure whether... not sure. Anyway, he did. They did go to several places they did go to several places. Let me see if I can grab Dave. Maybe I can add him to the group call here. Let's see. Let me call his mobile phone and see if we can get him that way. Okay, it's ringing. We'll see if we can't get him on via his mobile phone. Us. He's the only one that has the information. I guess they went to the school board meeting, and that was let out. And there were several people who were talking at the school board meeting, several people from around the country, apparently 10 people. They went to the police department. They went to
This is Dave. I'm sorry I couldn't be here to get your call personally, but please leave a message after the beep, and I'll get back to you.
Okay. Hey, Dave. We are calling you to have you be on the program, so I'm not sure where you are at. I don't know what to do here. You said you were going to call in, and that isn't happening. So, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. You know what? Let me tell you what happened. It's very simple.
Yeah,
what
no,
happens?
I don't know what I'm doing.
No, you didn't. I did. What happens is when you stay in these hotels, they sometimes have this free internet access.
Uh-huh.
And some of them, when you stay in the hotel, it'll allow you 24 hours of internet access from when you signed up. So what happened was I'm trying to log into Skype, and I keep getting Skype Wi-Fi where they want to charge me like 19 cents a minute, and I couldn't figure out what it was. The reason was that I had to re-sign up for the internet. Even though it's complimentary, I still had to re-sign up for it. So it's my fault. I apologize. I don't know what was happening when you were there, but that's what happened. So sorry for delaying the show.
That's okay, because my Skype would not work to call in, so I had to call in the host call-in number. And so anyway, I'm not sure what was going on with the logistics, but hey, we're together, we're talking. Hopefully people are listening, even though this is an hour earlier than what we were scheduled to be on. And the reason that it's an hour earlier is because plans changed. So you want to tell us about how the plans changed and what occurred here?
Sure. Sure, I do. But I want to say that I can hear, like, you breaking away, your voice. I don't know if the listeners can hear that at the same time.
Huh.
But I think it might have to do with Skype. And because sometimes when you have more than one person on a show, it creates, or on a line, it creates this issue. And so, as a matter of fact, I tried to call in to the show using that 347 number, but it didn't work. And
yeah, well,
maybe
it's kind of funny. It didn't work when I called into the program via Skype, so I had to call in the host calling number.
Yeah, right. So there's something, and Blog Talk Radio does have issues occasionally. And so that might have something to do with it, but it sounds okay now. I mean, do I sound all right? Am I coming over okay?
Yeah, you sound fine.
Okay,
you probably sound better than I do.
I don't know.
Well, I still have whether it's another cold or hay fever or whatever. But anyway, tell us why the other two gentlemen are not going to be with us.
Okay, well, that is because I found out that they're going to be on this, and I've never heard this other, I've heard of it, I've never listened to a program, but this fellow Rents, I guess Jeff Rents, the guy with the, is that the guy with the funny hair?
Yeah, I mean,
I don't know, is that real hair, or is it like a joke, or?
I don't know whether it's a joke, I'm not sure what it is. It could be real, and it could also be a joke, I mean.
Yeah, it could be a real joke.
Oh, that's not nice. I'm sorry, Jeff. Sorry.
No. It is. It's kind of funny looking. I mean, that's just the fact of the matter.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah. So
he's known by that look. So I don't know.
Yeah. No. But at any rate, they're going to be on his show at midnight Eastern time.
Holy cow.
Yeah. So I think they are. I know they are exhausted because I've been with them the whole time.
Sure.
And I know that that everybody's tired because it was a long, you know, it's one of these trips where it's only literally, you know, 24 hours of you know, being together, but it feels like, you know, an entire week. So
is that because the company wasn't good or what?
No, it's because there were so many things packed into this trip here to Newtown and Sandy Hook that
it was
actually very interesting. If you want, I'll get into it.
Sure.
Right away.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. So what happened was that as you may have explained while I was bungling trying to get on your show, was that this was planned for a little while, and I don't remember who it was, if it was Wolfgang Halbig or if it was Jim Fetzer, who said, "Hey, Dave, are you going to be, you know, coming to Sandy Hook and covering this?" And I said, "Well, you know, that sounds like a good idea. You know, I'll I'll look into it. And I ended up saying, yeah, you know, I think I will. And as it turned out, I came up. Now, today is Tuesday, right? And it's 9:12 on the East Coast. So I came up yesterday, and I'm staying in Danbury, which is about, it's less than 10 miles away from Newtown and Sandy Hook.
Right.
And those guys, Halbig and Fetzer, are staying up in Windsor, which is about 60 miles north of Danbury. So once I got in, I ended up driving up there. I got there about 8:30 last night, and when I arrived at their hotel,
they were staying where?
They were staying Windsor.
Was it that at the Marriott or?
No, they were staying at Courtyard. Courtyard.
The Marriott Courtyard. Okay.
Courtyard Marriott. I'm staying at the Hampton Inn.
Okay.
And excuse me. And so I went in there, and I asked one of the workers there if he knew where these fellas were. And he told me they're in, you know, this conference room, and he walked me over there. And it wasn't just Wolfgang and Jim Fetzer. It was about maybe 8 to 10 other people.
Okay.
And they had, as I found out, they were from all across the country. So one lady was from Houston, Texas. He had his attorney coming in from Carson City, Nevada. You had a couple of people coming in from Wisconsin. You had people from New York.
Do I name any, or do you know who they are?
No, you know, I'm horrible with names, but I know that the lady's name was Michelle. I think Michelle Murphy.
Okay.
And the two guys from Wisconsin, I think they came together. And they were like a film crew.
Okay.
And then the attorney was a guy named Day Williams, I think his name was, and he's out of, like I said, Carson City, Nevada.
Uh-huh.
And then there were a couple of nice people. You know, they were just there to, you know, they were obviously inspired by Wolfgang and what he was doing. And I would say, like I said, between 8 and 10 people. And, you know, so we're in the conference room there talking, and I met everybody. I met Wolfgang, and I had never met these people before, and Jim Fetzer, and and there was, I'm trying to jog my faulty memory, and there was another fellow who had been up there, and I can't remember his name, but he was from New York State, and he had come up there regularly, or down, wherever you get to this area from New York State, and he did a lot of filming, and I guess he was kind of well-known there, that people had seen him filming, so... So we were in there for about, I guess, an hour, and then I said, okay, let's go up.
And what were they talking about?
They were talking about, you know, Sandy Hook, and they were being interviewed.
Who was interviewing them?
Well, the attorney was interviewing Jim Fetzer when I had gotten in there.
And what specifically were they talking about?
You know, I wasn't listening to him because I was talking to the other people, but...
Oh, okay.
And I didn't want to interrupt him. And then, you know, Jim was the last guy that I actually said hello to because...
Okay. You didn't bug yourself and say...
Actually, hey. I did bug myself, but I still don't know how to get them working.
Okay.
That's the problem. I bought these, you know, these secret recording devices, but I couldn't figure them out. I'm no 007, that's for sure.
Okay. So you didn't have anything in your shoe?
I had... Would you believe
it? I had nothing.
Nothing. Nothing. Like Maxwell Smart.
Yeah, speak into my lapel, please.
Right, Chief. And it was good, and then we went up to... What happened was we were going to go up to a room there. Someone was saying they were going to interview Wolfgang with their whole camera system and everything, and Jim Fetzer had asked me to come over to his place and you know, the same hotel there in his room and read his recent article that he wrote about Sandy Hook. And so I hung out with Jim for a little bit, and then when I got back to Wolfgang's room, Wolfgang was gone.
Uh-huh.
And the two fellows were there from Wisconsin, and we hung out and chatted, and bright guys, and they know the score. They know what's going on. And I got back here late, about 1 o'clock, and got up at 7:30, and And one other fella who is an American Free Press listener and reader and supporter, he actually came up from Long Island, and we met for breakfast, and then we drove over together to the first stop today.
And what was the first stop? Where did you go first?
We went to, I think it was 85 West Street in Danbury, which was the United Way.
Okay.
So we went there, and we got there, I'm going to say, about maybe 9:15. Everyone else had gotten there about 9 o'clock. I think that's what they told me. Well, when we pulled into the United Way, there were about 5 or 6 or 7 police officers.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like blocking the door. Yeah,
did somebody give the police or any of the authorities there or anybody there some sort of an itinerary? Or did the United Way call? And what did Halbig and Fetzer expect to obtain from the United Way?
Yeah, I don't know about an itinerary to the United Way, but I know that they had let the Newtown Police Department know that they were in town, and I think Wolfgang's catchphrase is, they came to my house, now I'm going to their house.
Uh-huh.
That, and so he let them know, but as far as the United Way goes, I believe that they were looking for records. They wanted to inspect the records of where these donations went to.
I don't think that, how is that going to prove anything? I mean,
I don't know. That's, you know, all I know is that they were denied entry.
Okay.
And there were police on bicycles, and there were police in regular squad cars, and police in SUVs, and males and females, and, you know, some of them seemed pleasant, some of them seemed not so pleasant. And they basically, what happened was that when they got to the United Way, they were knocking on the back door and nobody came. And I guess the person who was in there in the United Way's building called up the police and said, you know, there's a riot going, or there's protesters. They said,
so the United Way actually didn't know who all these people were?
Or they said that they didn't know. So
what do you think? Do you think they knew who it was?
Probably. I would say that they probably knew, because he has carved out a niche for himself in this here, and based on one of the comments that was said to him at the school board meeting tonight by one of the people saying, you know, you're hated by the 30,000 residents in this town.
Yeah.
I think that there's a lot of people who know him.
Did they recognize him when that he didn't have his uniform on?
What do you mean uniform? What?
Well, did they recognize him because he didn't have his Florida State Trooper uniform on?
No, I don't think they were associating him as a Florida State Trooper. But But he looked, you know how some people don't look like they look in.
Sure. Did he look like he looked?
He looks exactly like that.
Okay.
Exactly. So he looked exactly like that.
Did he have a white shirt on and that tie?
He did. And I told him, I said, I'm glad you're wearing that white shirt with those khaki pants. Because it looks exactly like, you know, when you, on the internet.
Sure.
And no, I don't think there was a tie, though.
Oh, okay.
But yes. So, what happened?
Okay.
No, please go ahead. I'm listening.
Oh, I was just so. Okay. So he looked exactly like he does on the internet. Okay.
Exactly. So what happened was that these these people who were there as well, the other group of people who had come to Sandy Hook, to Newtown to be with Wolfgang, they were also in the parking lot, and and a lady came out of a salon, the spa that was next door, and asked very nicely that, you know, this is for our customers, and would you mind?
Well, that makes sense. I mean,
yeah, and she even said, she said, well, you know, they're not going to be coming in for another half hour or so. But
the people at United Way weren't even actually there. Maybe it was a janitor.
I don't know. I don't know because they never opened the door. You know,
there's
protesters out there. But the spa lady was said, you know, can you move them in about a half hour? But then this one, you know, cop who wasn't very friendly, he exercised his authority and made everybody move their cars, you know, like, you know, 100 feet away, you know. So.
Okay.
So they did, and then it went on, and there was one officer who was kind of like the spokesperson dealing with Wolfgang. You know, why he said, look, basically, you know, this is a, you know, a charity, but, you know, that doesn't mean that, you know, you have a right to go in there. You know, this is private property. And
well, of course, yeah.
They say they don't want you there, then, you know, they could, you know, he said, because I asked one of the cops, I said, and he said, look, he said, it's a charity, but it's private property. Does that mean that anybody can have access? He says, I don't know. I'm not a lawyer, you know. And I said,
sure.
So after, you know, after that was over, then the next stop was into downtown Danbury to go to one of the papers there. And I don't know if it was the Danbury, I don't know if it was the
Newtown Bee?
I don't think so, but I could be wrong. It might have been Danbury Times.
Okay.
And so they went in there, Fetzer and Halbig went in there. I believe it was just them. And I guess they just wanted to let the paper know what happened over at the United Way. And they were in and out of there very, very quickly because we were out on the street there by the parking meters.
So why would they want to let the newspaper know?
Well, I guess because they felt that, you know, their rights were trampled on, that they should have let them in, you know, with, you know, these requests, you know, Freedom of Information Act requests, and they had the right to
accept. Did they do a Freedom of Information request to United Way?
I don't think so, because I think that they believed that they had the right to examine these documents.
Well, it didn't. I mean, that's if it's private charity. I mean, that would be like somebody coming to your home and saying, "We'd like to examine your financial records." I mean, that's just. Didn't their lawyer inform them that the United Way is a private charity?
You know, I don't know what this lawyer's specialty is or was. But the lawyer was under the impression that they should have then been able to do that. But, you know, apparently they were not. And like I said, they had like, you know, 7, 8, maybe 10 cops there, Danbury cops.
That's weird. So yeah. This lawyer is from Nevada?
Carson City, Nevada.
Carson City. Yes. How did they happen to get a lawyer from Carson City, Nevada?
I don't know if the lawyer contacted Wolfgang, because I spoke a little bit to the lawyer today during a lunch break, and he I guess he got turned on to, you know, the alternative stuff through Sirhan. Somehow he met somebody in Carson City, Nevada, who had something to do with Sirhan.
Well, that's then, where John Coleman has, I believe he has, an office there or a publishing firm there. I know my parents used to live there before they passed away.
Okay. I don't know. I don't know. But whatever the case may be, they couldn't get in. And so they went to the paper and to let the paper know. I don't think the paper was interested, but I wasn't there.
Okay.
And then the next stop after that was the Newtown Police Department.
And why did they go there?
He wanted to, I guess, talk to the chief there, the chief of police.
For what?
And I guess to
to talk to him about his perhaps his 16 questions.
Okay.
Or I think primarily to let him know that he's there. He's in town.
In case they wanted to arrest him for something or what?
Maybe. I mean, I don't know about the arresting, but just to let him know that, hey, you know, I'm here. We're in town.
Defense in town? I'm sorry.
That's okay. Hey, it's your show. You know, if you want, you can do whatever you want, you know? But they ran in out of the police station very quickly. You know, in the Newtown Police Department, it was funny, I took a bunch of pictures. And,
now, how big
and
is Newtown, this police department? I mean,
very small. It looks like, it really looked like, one of the guys there said it looked like a, you know, like a lobster shanty, because it's got that blue rough paneling and literally if you took, you know, two wooden cutouts of, you know, red lobsters and put it on there, it would look like a lobster place. And a lobster restaurant, and you know, Newtown Police Department. It looked like almost like a trailer, like a modified trailer.
Sure.
It wasn't any compared to like the Danbury Police Department.
Sure. Well, a town of 30,000 people is not going to have a great big huge wonderful police department building. I guess I don't know.
Well, I don't know. I know in my town, which is not even 20,000, their police department is very nice. So I don't know why Newtown literally looks like a temporary trailer facility. But at any rate, after that, then, let's see, first it was United Way, then it was the newspaper, then it was the police department. Then I believe the next stop was the fire, the Sandy Hook.
Sandy Hook
Volunteer Fire Department. Yeah. And that was that is the building that is right next door to Gene Rosen's house.
Right.
And is right next door to the road that led to Sandy Hook Elementary School.
Sure. Now, did they stop in to see Gene Rosen?
No. They did not stop in to see Gene Rosen. And
how come? I mean, it was right next door.
I don't know. I do know that Wolf is talking about renting a home in Sandy Hook for 6 to 8 months to live there and to write a book.
Okay.
So what happened is that fire station there, you obviously can't pull into the front because they got all the bay doors there in case there's a fire.
Sure.
You have to get out. But when you pull in the back is very large, and they have like a work area in the back. And so you got to remember, it's not just Wolfgang. Now you got a caravan of cars.
Okay.
You got like six cars, you know,
okay,
people from all over the country here now.
Sure.
coming to see what's going to happen here.
Sure.
And so we all pull in, and Wolfgang is already out of the car, and he's walking towards this guy who's, you know, in like the workshed area. And, you know, then I hear like words being exchanged.
Like what kind of words?
Like curse words. Oh. And, you know, go ahead.
Who's cursing who?
The fire guy is cursing at Wolfgang.
Now, who was the fire guy?
He's just a fireman there. And
okay, he's volunteer fireman.
Volunteer fireman. Supposedly he was an ex-cop.
Were there any words that weren't curse words that you can repeat?
Yeah. He said that, he said as he was walking away that you have 1 minute to get out of here.
All righty. But what was the problem? What was the problem?
The problem was that he thought that Wolf was a wacko.
Okay. And why did he think that?
Because they heard about him. Because I guess he had announced his presence and they knew about him, and they knew why he was coming here, and that from what I gathered from the few people that I saw, and obviously we'll talk about the board meeting later on, but the attitude of these people is that, you know, these out-of-towners here coming here to say that Sandy Hook is a hoax, and they're out of their minds.
Now, did this fireman participate on December 14th of 20?
I don't know. He wasn't very nice, And I even tried to talk to him, but as he was walking by me, very close to me, he didn't even look at me. So I wasn't even able to, you know, get an answer from him. I just simply asked him, is it all right if I go to the front of the building to take a couple of photographs?
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, he didn't answer me. So what happened was everybody cleared out, and then the next stop was, I believe, and I could be wrong because you know how memories are. I believe that the...
Especially with older people.
Yeah, right, exactly. Older wounded people.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, that's okay. That's okay, it's true. And the next stop, I think it was lunch. But I could be wrong. But let's just say it is. If some form of a memory returns, then I'll say, wait a second, I was wrong. But I think it was lunch, and one of the fellows who came along said, you know, I saw a really nice place in, like, kind of like downtown, Sandy Hook, and it was a place called the Foundry Restaurant. You know what? I'll get you the name right now.
Okay.
As we're talking.
Well, the Foundry Restaurant sounds good.
Yeah, and it was right on some water, which was really cool.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was in Newtown. Yeah, it was Foundry Kitchen and Tavern in Sandy Hook.
Okay.
And the website is foundrykitchenandtavern.com.
Okay. And Sandy Hook is relatively small, correct? You can walk it probably very rapidly, right?
Yes, it's not what I thought it would be.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not like, I guess a lot of folks had the impression that Sandy Hook is, a bunch of wealthy people and, you know, you're going to see, you know, all of these, rich people there. And it's not like that. It's there's a lot of, I don't want to say white trash. Well, the hell with it. I will say white trash. No, I'm not going to say white trash, but I'm going to say there's a lot of poor people there.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of rundown homes. And the roads are, you know, the roads leave a lot to be desired. And so does a lot of the scenery. It's not a place I would move to. It's not an elite area. You know,
yeah, and you would think that it would be. People have kind of said that this is, well, it's an old area, but given the homes that we have seen, for instance, the Lanza home, which is quite nice, and the neighborhood that they lived in, you kind of get the impression that everybody in Sandy Hook lived like that. That Lanza home represented the general population.
Right, and that's absolutely not the case because you have these nicer homes and right next door to these not nice homes, literally right next door. And you don't really see stuff like that very often.
Sure.
You know, traveling around the country, you might see, you know, a whole block of nice homes and then you might see one not so nice home. But here it seemed like they were, you know, interspersed regularly.
Okay.
It's nothing. It's an old town. It looks like an old mill town. There's nothing extraordinary about it.
Okay.
And that road next door to the firehouse has cones. You're not allowed down there, where they obviously demolished the school.
And that was where the sign. There was a sign that was a couple of days. Well, it was Tuesday. After the event, that said everyone must check in, and that was in front of the firehouse that day, but it was not there on Friday. And is that was the sign still there or?
No, the sign wasn't there, and that sign was on the left side of the firehouse.
Okay.
And the road is on the right side of the firehouse.
Okay.
And the sign is closer to Gene Rosen's home. So Gene Rosen's home is up on a hill. See, and that's something that is curious if you think about it. If that whole Gene Rosen thing, and I'm not an expert at this, but this whole Gene Rosen thing is kind of strange because here, if these children walked out from this school all the way down that road, they passed some kind of a commercial building that's set off the road a bit, surrounded by trees. They could have gone there. They had to go right by the firehouse.
Mm-hmm.
They could have gone there. I mean, I'm sure children associate firemen with policemen.
Mm-hmm.
And why wouldn't they go there? But instead, they went past the firehouse, which has a broad entryway, parking space in front of the bays, and they then went up to Gene Rosen's house on the hill, and there are no sidewalks. There's no sidewalks in the town.
Mm-hmm.
Except maybe there are some in like the center of town there.
Mm-hmm.
They're putting in these brick paver type sidewalks,
mm-hmm,
with marble facing. And it was curious to me, especially because there is a lot of traffic in town.
Mm-hmm.
And it is that these kids wouldn't be stopped by someone on the road going to this guy's home, which really doesn't make any sense from what I saw, because I spent like an hour or hour and a half there, you know, surveying the
sure
lay of the land. And it just,
well, they were 6-year-old kids. It's hard to know what they were thinking.
Yeah, but again, the whole Gene Rosen thing to me just doesn't seem to make sense. It's a mystery. So.
Yeah. Now, some people have said that he belonged to the Actors Guild, but that's a totally different Gene Rosen. Gene Rosen has always lived in that area. And this other Gene Rosen that supposedly belongs to the Actors Guild has lived in various parts of the country. So,
yeah. No, look, even if that was true that he was, he's not a very good actor. But it just seems odd that this guy would have these kids in there playing these games and not calling the police and, you know, hey, we got a bunch of kids in here.
Yeah.
What's going on here? I mean, why would you want to do that? Why wouldn't you want to let the cops know? Why wouldn't you? So that's what I'm saying. It just
seems
kind of...
Well, yeah, it was bizarre. Yeah.
Yeah, it is bizarre. It's not normal. You don't act like that.
Sure.
You know?
Well, Gene Rosen was... I think he's a peculiarity.
Yeah, and so is the coroner. He's a peculiarity, you know, so there's a lot
I think
of...
There's some, yeah, I've been kind of analyzing the Carver's remarks, and I think that there's some legitimate reasons why he may have... Why he may have said some of the things that he said, but that has nothing to do with the trip.
Yeah, no, you know, he was mentioned.
Did anybody go visit him?
No, nobody visited him.
Okay.
And what happened was that after the firehouse, the first firehouse debacle, then lunch, it was at that foundry, and one other fella showed up who wasn't with the group the previous evening. And because Wolfgang and Jim Fetzer, they got in at around, I think, about 5:30 or so, and then or Wolfgang got in first, and then he rented a car and went and picked up Jim Fetzer over at the airport. And then everybody got together, I guess, about 7:30. But like I said, I didn't know, and that's what I remember. A couple of people were saying, look, I had no idea there were going to be other people here. That's,
sure,
you know, they were just coming expecting to meet Wolfgang.
Sure.
But it was a whole slew of people. So then the lunch was, it was okay. I mean, nothing to write. Look, I wouldn't go back to the place, right? That's just my opinion, you know, from what I had.
So what'd you have?
I had a smoked brisket sandwich with French fries, and I asked them if they had fresh brewed iced tea, and you know, if they had free refills, because I, you know, I'm not going to pay for refills of,
sure,
of iced tea. You know, that's ridiculous.
Okay.
You know, it's uncalled for. And so I they said we do, and so I guess people heard me saying that, and a bunch of other people then got the iced tea.
Okay.
And it ended up that I had stepped outside for a phone call. And it ended up that when I got back in, place was cleaned up, and the bill was paid by Wolfgang. So
there goes your iced tea. No more refills.
No, I had like six of them. No, I'm good. Yeah, I got my money's worth. Well, I got Wolfgang's money's worth. And so
he paid for everybody?
He paid for everybody, I found out.
Wow.
And yeah, and my meal was, I think mine was maybe like $8 or something.
Okay.
I don't know how much the iced tea was, but it wasn't a fancy place.
Okay.
Nobody was drinking alcohol. It was just, soda, water, or iced tea.
Okay.
And they were modest meals.
Did anybody talk?
Appetizers or anything. Yeah.
Did anybody talk to the people that worked there?
No.
Did they ask any questions? Like, were you here that day? Were you here?
No. Okay. Nobody asked any questions. As a matter of fact, when I came in there, I cracked a joke, and I said, oh, they're probably not going to let us eat here, like throwing us out. And Wolfgang, kind of made like a sign, like, no, don't let them know anything, because I guess they didn't want.
Because he was hungry.
You're funny. I was hungry too, and it was kind of like an au jus sauce there, and like I said, it was okay. The waitress was very good. She was terrific.
Okay.
She really handled. She just went around and handled us all perfectly, and got us everything we needed. And
she probably wondered where you all came from.
You know what? If she did, she didn't let on that she did wonder at all. You know, there aren't that many. I would think that people would wonder, who the heck are these people? Because there weren't that many. You could tell it was locals.
Sure. No,
it's all locals.
Sure. Well, I would have been asking, hey, where are you from? You guys come to town for business, or?
Remember, you're up in New England, and it's not really like that.
It's not like going to Texas.
It's just not like, even Texas isn't like that. It's not like going to Illinois. Illinois, the people are friendly. That. I mean, you're there. I mean, I lived there, and I was there in the Navy, and the Midwest is completely different from the Northeast.
Right. Yeah, I've traveled quite a bit, and I know there are different areas of the country, and they're different. They talk different. They act different. And I've been to New England. And
so they weren't, nobody really cared. It was just like, you came in, for some chow, you sit down, we'll take care of you, and you're gone. But the pretty thing about that place was when you park in the back, huge parking lot, like a gravel parking lot, when you park in the back, you have to walk up these pavers up a hill to get to the restaurant. And of course, there's that beautiful big stream, maybe 30 feet across, going over, very, very pretty. If anybody ever does get there and go to the Foundry, like I said, my sandwich wasn't that good. I could have had, not so great sandwich, but I mean, if anybody does get into town, just, even if you're not going to eat there, go take a look at that. Cause what a beautiful stream. So I think after lunch, because he said that the fire chief was going to be back in an hour.
Okay.
So we went to, I think people got, the caravan got lost, and finally we all ended up in the same place, and it was some kind of a park.
Okay.
The moms were with their kids, and not very many. It was about 60 something degrees, but it was cloudy and a little chilly. And it kind of like, here you got a bunch of people who are kind of like vagabonds, they're just, traveling around. They're getting, chucked and tossed from everywhere they go, And so, it's tiring like that, It's just, you can't go back to your room and kick your feet up and relax.
Sure. So the people in that area are kind of reticent anyway. I mean, they're not going to be super duper friendly to a bunch of people who come in to basically question what happened.
Absolutely not.
Sure. They wouldn't be friendly even if you came to town to visit relatives, probably.
I think that the way that they are is kind of a little standoffish.
Uh-huh.
And, you know what word I would use? I would use flinty.
Okay. Okay, hard, cold.
Yeah, hard,
okay.
Cold, and
okay.
You know, they have that look to them.
Especially if you're really kind of implying that everybody in Sandy Hook is a big liar.
Right. Well, and that actually came out at the board meeting, which we'll get to.
Sure. Okay. So you went back.
So we were
to
at that
fire
park.
Station.
Well, we went okay. to that park for a little while, and then said, "Hey," I looked at my watch. I said, or my phone. Because who wears a watch nowadays, right? I looked at my phone and I said, hey, it's almost 2 o'clock. And then finally said, okay, let's go back to the fire station. And then went back to the fire station. And that's when the real fireworks started. Because, actually, let me back up. Because remember I told you about that memory thing? There was one other stop that we made.
Okay.
Wolfgang wanted to see this this Crestwood Avenue. He was calling it Crestview, but it wasn't Crestview. It was Crestwood.
Okay.
And it was the road where it's claimed that these police pulled into that road instead of in front of the school.
Uh-huh.
And in that area, there was the woods where supposedly the guy was running
camouflage,
yeah, I guess,
okay.
Yeah. And of course,
Manfredonia, okay.
Manfred, right, I guess. Mm-hmm. And so I think it was they were looking at some homes there, and it was Crestwood, and this was in right in Newtown, Connecticut. And I don't really know for sure the difference between Newtown and Sandy Hook. You know, they're kind of like
one is across the river from the other.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, you would know. You've studied the heck out of this stuff, right? and so we were, you know, this street was a dead end. And so it was Crestwood Drive, right? That's the one that's literally backs up
right to
Sandy Hook.
Yeah.
That's right, right to the school.
Yeah.
And so what happened was we pulled in there, you know, the caravan pulled in there and then I guess turned around and faced as we were going to leave, turn the cars off, and the fellow that I was with, I was with that guy from New York. He came up from Long Island, and so I was sitting. You know, I'm still on a cane because of my leg and everything, so
mm-hmm.
I feel like walking any more than I had to. So I'm sitting in his Jeep, and all of a sudden, because it's a road that goes down to that main road in the center of town. And so right near the Foundry restaurant. And so all of a sudden I see these lights, police car come up. Lights weren't on, but I saw the rack of lights. And so cop came in, pulled past us and the other cars in the caravan and went to the end of the road, I guess, the dead end. I never turned around to look at him, but the whole time that he was there for about 15 minutes or so. And then another cop car came in, maybe 5-10 minutes after that. And then he pulled forward and went into somebody's driveway, backed into somebody's driveway. And that homeowner came out who was working outside. He said, you could hear him. He said, can I help you? And I guess he was explaining then to the homeowner why he was there.
Uh-huh.
Because when we drove out of there, I could see the homeowner kind of, gave a look like, who are you? Why are you here? What are you doing on my street? And you don't believe, kids were killed, that kind of look.
Sure.
And so then what happened was then I think after we visited Crestwood Drive, then I think that's when we went to the firehouse the second time.
Okay. Then what happened then?
Well, then what happened was that, we pulled in and I wanted to get some pictures of the firehouse, with the stars on top of because what it is they've got this, the 26 stars on top of that roof.
Right.
And six of them are large for the adults, and the
right.
20 of them are small. And they even have a flag, a green flag with, it looks like a snowflake.
Uh-huh.
And, they got the six large stars on the points. It's like a six-pointed star
right.
as well.
Right.
And then hanging underneath the American flag, and And then they got that hitch a ride on the stars or something like that.
Sure.
You know, that plaque there, and I took some pictures. And then I see Wolfgang and that other that fireman, then, and he's basically cursing at Wolfgang with the F word,
mm-hmm.
you know, pretty strongly, and he pushed him.
Mm-hmm.
And then he closed the door. You know, he's basically telling, you know, get the F out of here, F you, you know. And,
mm-hmm.
You know, because he, I guess he had a lot of hatred for Wolfgang.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were told that, you know, hey, okay, we're not leaving now. Wolfgang's going to call 911.
For what?
Because he was assaulted.
Well, was he actually assaulted? I mean,
yeah, physically and verbally, he was assaulted, and it was caught on videotape. So what happened was the cops showed up. There were, I believe, three cops that came. One cop stood there the whole time, about 20, 25, 30 feet away from the group of people who were standing on the corner of the firehouse property by the road that used to go to the school, and just like observing them.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a female cop who I heard was pretty nasty, because I was sitting in the Jeep with my buddy and
mm-hmm.
you know, just watching from across the street. So where we were sitting, we were looking down on the firehouse. To the right was the road, and to the left, of course, was Gene Rosen's house, which
mm-hmm.
is up on the hill. And so, you know, they're taking the report. Wolfgang is giving his version of what happened, and then they interviewed Jim Fetzer, and then I guess they interviewed the fireman who did the pushing and the cursing. Of course, Wolfgang was not cursing.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard him curse once, you know, as guy talk, joking around.
Mm-hmm.
But I, you know, he's not that kind of a person. He's not foul mouthed.
Mm-hmm.
So he did not, while this guy was cursing him, he did not curse him back or anything
mm-hmm.
at all. And so this whole reporting thing, and then, the fellow who took the video, he had to go to the police station so they could, I guess, copy the video. And the whole thing took a while.
Now, did Wolfgang, at any point in time that you know of, ask the police department there in Newtown if they had sent the local Florida authorities from the sheriff's office whether they had done that to his home?
I'm unaware of that.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm unaware of that.
I mean, that would be a logical question because he did accuse him of doing that.
And I would say that if he did ask them that they would not have answered him. Because let me tell you, nobody was saying anything.
Okay.
Nothing. I mean, people. And when we get to the school board meeting, you know, something very interesting happened there.
Okay.
But these people are not talking
okay.
at all. You know, they're just not talking. So I said,
but
hey.
That's typical of the area, what you say.
Yes, that's what I believe. That's
okay.
Right. They're a flinty group of people. They're
okay.
not going to talk.
Okay.
So, of course, there are exceptions to everything, but
sure.
I don't think these – I think that – this type of behavior is probably, you know, more ingrained in the wool of these people than it's in other people.
I have talked to several people from that area, and they've been very nice.
Yeah, I mean, I guess maybe because, you know, were you talking to them about Sandy Hook?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, well, I mean, did they know that? Did they know your viewpoint of Sandy Hook, or?
I don't know that I actually had the opportunity to tell them my viewpoint. I was just very, I don't have the reputation of calling it a hoax. I've never said, well, I think it's a big hoax. I've never said that. And I think that probably Wolfgang's reputation preceded him. So I think
definitely.
That, but I've talked to several people, and they were just very cordial. So I don't know.
Yeah, it was. It seemed like the entire town, anywhere we went, and of course I was not saying anything. You know, not my position to say anything, but it seemed like the entire town was clamming up.
Well, did they? He's been saying that he's been going to come there, go there. So I'm sure that somebody, you know, mentioned it to the whole town. I'm sure that everybody in town knew he was there.
Yeah, I think so. It's a small town, and he was told that the, you know, Newtown Police Department, you know, reads, listens to American Free Press, so they know about, like you said, they know about what's going on. So what happened was that went on there with that altercation there at the volunteer fire department, which the reason that they were throwing Wolfgang off and everybody else ostensibly, and I don't know enough about it, but the reason was is supposedly it's not public property. Somehow it's private.
Right.
And I don't know if somebody donated it to them. You know,
it's a volunteer fire department. It isn't, you know, they raise their own funds. They have a Christmas tree sale every year. And they are a private organization of volunteer firemen. So they really, it isn't like the fire department that's down the street from me that is paid for by public taxes.
Right. Yeah. So he, you know, eventually, it's, you know, he saw, look, you got to go back to they got to bring the film, you know, see what the sergeant thinks about the film and so on and so forth. And so I said, hey, you know, let's take a break, and then we'll hook up at the next stop. You know, the next stop was maybe, I know the itinerary called for catch a rising snow. I don't know what it was, but some type of another charity that didn't happen. And then there was the school superintendent, which didn't happen. And then what happened was the next part of the itinerary was to go to the school board meeting.
Did anybody go see the mortician that handled the 11 of the bodies?
No.
Okay. Anybody go to the cemetery?
No.
Okay. Anybody go to the Lonzo home just to drive by?
No.
Okay. So the school board meeting. Okay, here we go.
Yeah. Yeah, so the school board meeting was at 7:30 Eastern time.
Okay.
And this is in a complex of newer buildings, very nice looking buildings. And it was actually a very pretty evening. And I got there at about 7:15. I was able to actually get away from the group and me and the fellow that I was with and go back to the hotel and get refreshed a little bit, because like I said, you're out there on the road all day.
Sure.
Going here and there, and especially with my, you know, ambulating.
Sure.
And, you know, it was nice to kick back a little bit. And so what happened was I see that I park and I'm walking to, you know, to the front of this building, this government building. You know, a nice lawn and, you know, big, wide walkways. And there's a lot of camera crews there and a lot of people. It seemed like there were more camera crews than, you know, attendees of the board meeting.
So how many people did attend the board meeting?
I would say that locals, not very many. Maybe 10, maybe
okay.
Five. Yeah, it was nothing.
Okay.
It was hardly any. It was a lot of media was there. They had camera, you know, crews, video and still cameras, you know, all around taking pictures, mostly of Wolfgang.
Uh-huh.
And what happened was
he's so photogenic. Maybe that's why.
Yeah. Yeah, well, he, like I said, he looks exactly like he does. He looks exactly. It's amazing. And so what happened was that the meeting opened, and you have the, you know, the members there who were sitting up at the table. It's all level area.
Sure. Now, were any of these people that he had communicated with before?
Yes, yes. As a matter of fact, and the reason I know that is because when he got up to speak, he said that he had reached out to them and had gotten zero reply back. But I saw that actually up on the actual here. Where is it? Agenda for that's the agenda. But I saw the actual people, the board members. You know, the chair, the vice chair, the secretary, and then the other members. So there were about six of them, I think, and then other people up there, I guess maybe taking notes and whatever. And the tables were kind of in a semicircle up front, and then you had, of course, all the chairs lined up where the audience could sit, and then there were people standing in the back. And they opened it up, and I'm looking at the itinerary right here. Actually, I'll Skype it to you so you could go along with it. And it opened at 7:30. They didn't let anybody in until 7:30, and that was odd, they said, because usually they let people in 15 minutes before. But they knew Wolf was coming. And there was a guy there also who came from New York, who was dressed in like a colonial-type outfit that they would wear in the 1700s. And, you know, he spoke when it was the time for the public participation. And there was also this guy from, I think, InfoWars, Dan, I'm guessing, I could be wrong, Dan Biondi, I think his name is. He goes around and gets abused by people who curse at him. And, you know, he got cursed at by some politician in Rhode Island recently and, you know, went viral. And that guy was there, and NBC was there, an NBC correspondent was there. But what happened is we all went in at 7:30, and I actually sat right up in front, in on the right, furthest right-hand chair, and I was next to Wolfgang's attorney, and then Wolfgang was next to him. And so we had the Pledge of Allegiance, and then they mentioned a couple of things, and I guess Wolfgang had donated some money to Newtown because of the event. And I don't know if he thought then that gave him the right to speak, but I don't think it mattered, because item three there, if you're looking at it, is public participation. And in that part, that's when the chair asked, is there anybody in, you know, any of the members of the public who, you know, would like to speak? And Wolfgang, I believe it was Wolfgang, was the first to get up. And he spoke for a couple of minutes, and he was basically saying, you know, I reached out to all of you, and, you know, many times, email and called, and not once did I get any response back, and it's your responsibility, you know, you want to teach these kids what's right, you know, the truth, and you know, do what's right, and so on and so forth. And And while he was speaking, of course, you hear the cameras, you know, all over the place, you know, taking these pictures. And there was also video. And then after he spoke, then I'd say maybe about 10 other people spoke. And the last person who, including the guy who was dressed up as a colonial, the last person who spoke was a guy named Fitzgerald with an Irish accent, and he said, I'm a resident of Newtown. And, you know, he mentioned something about the circus being in town, and he knew a friend of his, or two friends of his, are cops, and, you know, they're still in, you know, in mental anguish over what they saw. And so he was insulted by these people coming in and doing this. And it's just a couple of things like that, you know, how he was kind of angry. about all this stuff. And so he was the last person to speak. And then after that public participation, they went into then their fourth item reports. And that's when pretty much everybody emptied out of the room because they weren't interested in hearing about this other stuff. They didn't care. So, you know, I lingered a little bit. I stood up and I went to the back. And then that guy Fitzgerald had got up to leave. And I said to him, can I speak to you a moment? He said, you know, sure. And so I said, okay, let's go out here. So we went outside and then I said, I heard what you were saying in there. And would you be interested in disseminating that, you know, publicly, you know, to an audience? And he was, explaining to me why he wouldn't want to do that and why he didn't think it would make sense. And he had a friend of his there, you know, who looked angry and, you know, looking at me, you know, who are you, you know? And I said, well, you know, I'm a reporter and, you know, who are you with? You know, I'm trying to talk to the, you know, Fitzgerald, like American Free Press. And, you know, I'm talking, well, who's American Free Press? And I'm trying to ignore this guy, you know, so I could. But the guy basically said in a nice way that, well, he doesn't think that it would help because for a month there were news crews blanketing this whole town. And if what they had to say to the, you know, to the public, I guess who listens and watches the mainstream media, all of those poor bastards who do that, you know, and I'm saying that, not him, but he said, if they couldn't get the message through, then I'm not going to be able to get the message. So
that's kind of it.
Sorry?
I'm sorry. I had myself muted.
Oh.
That is something that somebody told me when I approached somebody there in Newtown, and I said, I'd really like to interview some people. And this person said, one more sad interview or one more story about what happened is not going to convince anybody if people want to believe that it was a hoax. And so that's pretty much, that was her feeling. And certainly, apparently, it was this person's feeling also.
Yeah, and so I told him, I said, look, you know, what you're saying here, you know, that might go a long way to, you know, educating people. And he just, in a nice way, you know, he was not interested in it. And so what happened was that after it was over and everybody, you know, cleared out, I came out a little late to the front of the building, of the government building there. And by that time, all the news crews were set up. You know, NBC was interviewing, you know, they had the lights and everything. And it was still light outside, but...
Really? Now,
oh, yeah.
I wonder why NBC was doing this.
I have no idea.
Who notified them?
I have no idea. But the guy who was interviewing him, his microphone said, NBC correspondent.
Okay.
So, like I said, InfoWars was there, you know, for what they're worth.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really, you know, I don't watch anything as it is, but so I really can't comment. Maybe they're good, maybe they're not, I don't know. But,
mm-hmm.
But what happened was that I'm standing maybe about 20 feet away from the cameras and everything down the sidewalk. And of course the sidewalk leads to a parking lot. And this fellow Fitzgerald was, you know, coming out with his big friend with the bald head who was, you know, nasty. And he looked at me very nice. He said, it was, you know, pleasure to meet you. And I bowed my head. I said, yes, sir. You know, great to meet you as well. And you know, even though we just spoke for a short while, you know, he was being cordial. And then I said, I hope you understand why, you know, why I was at. And he said, oh yeah, I do. And his friend said, I don't. And so I was like, okay, you know. And then he said something, you know, and he said, walk away. I mean, I said, excuse me, you're telling me to walk away? I said, did I disrespect you in any way? Did I say anything to you? He was looking for a fight, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so he ended up walking away. you know, here I am on a cane. I couldn't have done much anyway.
Well, you could have maybe you could have beat him with your cane.
That's right, in the kneecap. Yeah, and if I missed, I would have been in trouble. But yeah, no. But the point is that this, you know, the guy was looking for a fight.
Sure.
And he wasn't going to get one for me.
Sure.
You know, I was just asking a question. That's all, because like I explained to Fitzgerald inside the building, you know, it would go a long way to have somebody say these things who knows people who died.
Sure.
He knows his friends who are cops are having a tough time mentally.
Sure.
You know, and this is what he's saying. Okay, I'm not saying it. This is what he's saying.
Sure.
You know, the listeners can decide if he's, you know, telling the truth or if he's lying. You know, it doesn't matter to me. I don't care. I don't have a, I guess, what do they say, a dog in this race
fight.
Or fight, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, whatever. So that happened, and you know, that guy left, and the board members, I saw that they were done, and you could see them through the glass doors and then they look out and they see all these camera crews and people, you know, lingering around, and they actually went out a different exit.
Sure. I mean, they've been, the town has been kind of assaulted with a lot of media during that time for a month after. That's, you know, so you can kind of understand their feelings, their mentality. So what exactly happened at the school board meeting?
Yeah, what happened was that they gave the public, you know, anybody who wanted to say anything, looked like about 3 minutes to speak, to say whatever they wanted. They all had stone faces. There were some people there who, you know, looked like, oh God, I got to hear this stuff, you know, and, you know, they weren't very happy that these people were even there. You know, it looked like, you know, hey, I wish you weren't alive. You know, why are you here? You know, leave us alone type of thing. And although they, like I said, they let the people say their mind, and some people, you know, were talking about, they were talking about the Second Amendment. Some people were talking about mental illness and you shouldn't punish everybody, you know, gun control. So it was just, you know, a gamut of ideas that people threw out about Sandy Hook. And again, I think that these people there were kind of, I guess the looks on their faces were kind of, they were just amazed, tired, wondering when it was ever going to wonder when it's ever going to end for them.
Yeah.
And one of the people actually even said that, or two, that this is not going to end. You know, what, just basically said, just tell the truth. Give us the truth that we're not going away. So almost threatening them.
Well, did Halbig ask any of his 16 questions of the school board?
Yeah, yes, he did. You know, the trauma helicopters,
mm-hmm.
The EMTs, you know, why weren't any, you know, just like that, exactly how it was.
But the school board that's not in their jurisdiction. I mean,
they didn't say anything. They said nothing, you know, literally zilch. I mean, zero zilch. They said nothing. You know, that's why I approached that guy Fitzgerald, because I figure, okay, here's a guy. He's a resident. He, you know, he has an idea what's going on. And, you know, because I don't think the school board's going to say anything. I tried to talk to a couple of cops. The cops were stone-faced and, you know, basically said they can't say anything. Nobody wanted to say anything. Nobody wants to dispel.
They can't say anything, or they won't say anything.
I don't know. But I don't know if they can say anything. They're probably afraid if they do that, you know, their jobs would be in jeopardy. And
why would you think their jobs would be in jeopardy?
This is the impression that I got. And actually, the last cop there that I talked to, Santucci, over at the, you know, the school board meeting outside, he said that you know, he would jeopardize his position if he talked. He can't have any opinion. They don't let, you know how it is nowadays. You cannot have an opinion. America's finished. You know that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, You can't speak your mind. It's a joke.
Well,
I speak
my mind all the time.
Yeah, you can. You're on the radio. I'm talking about average people. It's your job to, you know, it's your job to do this, but average people can't do it. They just can't. I mean, look at that guy who was one of the founders of, some tech guy. What was it, Mozilla? You know, the Firefox web browser?
Right.
You know, the guy donates, $1,000 because he doesn't believe in gay marriage, and he gets hammered.
Right.
I mean, what kind of a joke is this? What kind of a joke has this country turned into?
Sure.
I mean, think about it, where you can't even have your own opinion. It's a farce. It's not even a real – that's why, you know, we were talking, and there were a bunch of great people there who came to this event to see Wolfgang in action. And these people are bright. They know what's going on. You know, and I think most people have hope. You know, they maintain some kind of hope. And as I've said, you know, over and over again, I don't have any hope. You know, as far as I'm concerned, and I was telling him this, I believe that, you know, Skynet is already here. You know,
you know
what I'm talking about when I say Skynet?
Sure.
Okay, Skynet Industries, right?
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go back to the school board thing. So he asked the questions, and they would not answer. They did not answer any of them.
I don't think that they're supposed to answer anything. I think they're just supposed to allow the public the participation.
Okay.
And
so would you say that this entire trip was a bust?
As far as like gleaning any information?
Yes.
Yeah, of course. Wolfgang, though, considered it a success.
Why?
Because I guess the lack of information is as far as he was concerned, speaks volumes.
And so he's going to assume that because nobody answered his questions, that it was a hoax? Is that his assumption?
Well, I think that is what, you know, what he is, positing, that if you're not going to answer my 16 simple questions, then you're hiding something. What are you hiding?
Mm-hmm. But I mean, the school board was not in charge of calling for the helicopters or doing, I mean, that's out of their jurisdiction. Those would be questions that should be asked of the state police or the Newtown Police Department.
Yeah, like I said, every place that the caravan traveled to, they were shut out of. So he didn't get any answers. I don't know how he's going to get answers, but this route didn't really do anything.
Well, I've had programs where people have answered all 16 of those questions. I mean, he didn't really have to go to Newtown because most of those questions have been answered in the official records. So do you think that this was simply a sideshow to a predictable sideshow that he knew that the response would be the same kind of response that he received when he emailed them? What made him think that going there would get any more of a response from the people than his email?
You know, I don't know the answer to that, and I can't say if he actually knew that he wouldn't get these kind of answers. I don't know, you know, but I will tell you that because I'm logged on here as well, and there's actually a caller, and I think I recognize the number there.
Who? Let's see where. Oh, that one. Yeah. Okay. Let's take a call.
You know who that is?
That looks like a Keith Johnson.
I think so.
Okay, let's do that.
All right.
How do you do that?
I'll do it.
Okay, go ahead.
It's done.
Hey, Keith.
Hello, how are you? How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Oh, pretty good. You know, I watched the school board meeting on a video that they already have uploaded. So,
wow, where's that, Key? Where
yeah,
is it?
It's where is it? I do have it still up, I think. Okay. Let's see.
Is that a,
trying to find the link.
Justice.
Oh, you know, yeah. Well, it's. I got it from Wade. He sent me the link, and I'm going to my email right now to try to find out where that is.
Wait, I'm gonna ask Wade here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna ask Wade because he's in the chat room.
I don't know.
Okay, good.
I see him.
Yeah. Okay. There's a. Yeah, it's WW.
Here, I'm asking.
Well, it's a long thing, yeah.
Yeah, I'm asking him anyway, but go ahead. I mean, hey, what am I saying?
It's, hi, Steve. Yeah. Hey, Wade. Hi, how are you?
Wade's on there?
Yeah.
Well,
Wade's
in the chat room.
Wade, you can call him too.
Yeah, it's www.newtownct.gov/public documents.
Oh, okay.
I mean, forward slash.
I think he's gonna call.
Document.
I think he's gonna call in. He said, "Hi, I can call." He said, "I can call it," but I think he meant
yeah.
I can call it.
Yeah, I see that. Okay, yeah, that's
so,
good.
So he'll
well,
be calling in.
Well, I just wanted to comment on what I've seen. I saw part. I saw the I guess testimony or the 3 minute speeches that they gave individually up mm-hmm. until the guy. With the that was from Long Island. I guess he's part of InfoWars and came up with that other reporter, the guy from Massachusetts, the Bedaldi or something, the guy that gets chewed out by
Biondi.
Biondi. Yeah, it was.
Let me see if this is
it
Wade.
Was really.
Hold on a second.
Yeah, that looks like Wade.
Okay, I unmuted him. If this is Wade.
Okay, hey Wade, is that you?
Is this me? I'm here.
Yeah. Oh, hi,
hello.
How are you? This whole home week here.
Hi, Dave.
Hi.
Hi, Keith.
Hey, what's up?
Hello.
Wow, we got the whole crew here, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just wanted to say about the, you know, the school board meeting and the individual testimony that was given by Halbig. You know, Halbig comes across real well, you know, when he gets down, he sits down there and he talks to the people. He was very respectful. You know, I got to give him that. But he's basically asking the wrong people. He's asking a school board that can't ask his questions. And the questions that he's asked have already been answered numerous times. So at this point, I mean, I have no reservations in calling him a fraud because those questions have been answered. You know, he's asking about the trauma helicopters. Wade has already spoken on that. I've already discussed that the last major mass casualty incident was in Hartford. It was a mass shooting, and they had Lifestar helicopters on standby. They didn't use them then. They didn't use them this time. You know, and he goes, he talks about how EMTs weren't allowed in into the school and that they declared everyone dead in 8 minutes. I mean, these are old questions that have already been answered, not debunked, but just answered. I mean, there's really no need for him to be spending a lot of money to get these questions answered. I mean, he should be asking other questions, and I support you know, him getting certain kinds of documents that we'd all like to see because we believe that it would just prove our case even more that this was not a hoax and that it actually occurred. I think Wade is in agreement with me that there are some things that should be released, like pictures of Adam Lanza with the parent, you know, allegedly holding a gun to his head. You know, there's a lot of things that could quell a lot of the people out there who are asking for answers. And I mean, just the silence and them being secretive about things have inspired these conspiracy theories. So I think Wade could probably say more on that.
Let me just ask you, Keith, what was that web address again for that?
Yeah, that was www.newtown, and then what is that, a dash or a hyphen or ct.gov/public and then space documents.
I can probably.
And then forward slash Newtown CT, and then space web docs forward slash video archive MP.
can you just Skype it?
That's a mouth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you just Skype the thing?
Yeah. The gosh darn thing. Yeah. But also, I wanted to say that I think that most people are going to look at this because when I was viewing this thing, I don't know how it looked there, Dave, from your vantage point, but just looking at the video, the average person that looks at this are going to equate these Sandy Hook conspiracy theorists as a bunch of complete loons, especially with the guy with the, you know, the revolutionary garb. And the other guy, the Badaldi, who sat there and was giving a lecture about gun control. When, like I said, you know, why is he talking to these people about this? They have absolutely, you know, no decision on gun control legislation. It was just, it was really bizarre to look at.
Actually, every
mainstream
gun
media
activist cringed when Badaldi spoke.
My God.
There's no gun rights activist that wants him talking for us ever again.
I mean, he just looks like a meatball. He looks like a stupid meatball, you know. From, I mean, really, he looks like a stereotypical nut, something that you would put on television as a character in a comedy show. He really came across really, really bad. And like you say, Wade, I think that anybody who sees this and you know, a gun rights activist or gun rights group that sees this is just going to cringe. And I think that's what Scott Wilson, the guy who's I interviewed recently from Connecticut Citizens Defense League, you know, was fearful, or he at least expressed concern that this would be seized upon by the media to demonize gun owners, to make them look bad and just look like a bunch of nuts. And I think that's what this did. And if the mainstream media gets a hold of this and plays clips, you know that they're going to selectively cherry pick the most.
Sure.
Oh yeah, they're going to take this Badaldi. They're also going to take the guy with the that looks like he just. I mean, he looks like a homeless guy with the with the unshaven face and the guy from Long Island with the baseball cap and saying, you know, if you're a police officer, you go in there and you're going to go in every nook and cranny. And even if they're dead, you're going to bring out the bodies and you're going to lay them on the thing, on the triage. And that's what they're saying. You know, I mean, just really. I mean, if these people were representing my cause, I would have my head or my face in my palm the whole time. And I just couldn't look at it. But it was quite comical.
How was the video quality of that?
Oh, really good. I mean, it's really good. I saw you there, Dave, in the corner.
Really?
And I didn't. I saw. Well, yeah.
Oh, yeah. You look beautiful, Dave.
No, don't take this wrong. Don't take this wrong. I mean, I'm being honest. But you look like an overweight Cary Grant. You do. I mean, that's
Richie. I beg you.
How does he not take
you
that
say
wrong?
That?
How do you take that right?
It was that sandwich. I looked at him and go, "That's Cary Grant because he's just a little heavier than Cary Grant, and he's got a cane there." But hey, I'm overweight.
I can't think of a reason in the world why you would say that, Keith.
I see your
especially
picture in
preface
the sky.
If I don't
you've
take
obviously,
your...
Dave, you've not ever missed a meal, okay?
That's right.
Well, I mean,
right.
I'm never going on video.
I'm staying
this
on radio.
Guy,
that's it. Why do you think I'm on a cane? Too much fat to carry around.
I'm never
that's why they call me Cary. Cary Grant means carrying my fat around.
I mean, just the guys talking, you know.
Hey, did anyone feel sorry for those people? I did. My heart went out to Newtown tonight. That's the truth. God, this cast of characters comes in like that. And some of them were okay, but it's like this is it was a cast of characters. It's like you want to talk about a script? That seemed like a script. They're dressed in costumes, and, you know, they got the stoner guy or whatever he's supposed to be, and then the Revolutionary War guy, and then, you know, the schizophrenic lady. And it's like, what is this that we're watching here? But, and then Halbig, he's stuck to his original script from day one with Dave Gahary's interview and talks about EMTs, you know, and it's like he's all the way back in February.
Mm-hmm. Or January. I mean, he's never
really
changed
his
script.
I really felt, my heart really went out to them today that some of them people had to put up with this, really.
Yeah,
if you think about it this way,
know.
These people really went through that, then that's a whole different thing. See, what happens is there's been a lot of press spin and a lot of errors in the press, and there's been a lot of feeding of conspiracy theories. But the bottom line is, in a school building, 20 kids were shot, 6 teachers were killed, and that's what's happened there. So press spin aside, these people are attacking people that lost a lot that day. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, their faces, you know, like I said, I was explaining to Deanna, they weren't happy. They were disgusted.
Well, why would they be? These people know these people that died. These people aren't wondering, did this happen? We're removed. We're in another state. We don't have that personal connection. These people are not wondering if it happened. They worked every day, Soto. And then Soto got killed. So they worked every day with Don Hutchbrung. And then Don Hutchbrung got killed. They're not wondering if this happened. They lived it. In reality, we're the ones that watch the press and say, oh, the press spin this, the press spin that, and we're trying to piece it all together. These people really lost people that day. They lost students and friends, and so they have a different perspective, having lost a lot and been through this, and what they've been through all this time. So
you guys are in the minority here with, you know, the people in the alternative universe, you know, you,
sure.
Wade, and you, Keith, and you, Deanna, you know, the people in the alternative universe, you know, they don't like you at all. There's
sure.
there's a lot of loathing for you guys, and
yeah.
And I don't know about the audience tonight or the, you know, the archived audience, but you know, I could tell you that these people do not like you. You know, it's clearly, it's 99 to 1. They don't want to hear
on the internet.
How do you like those odds?
Millions
yeah.
of people know this happened, you know. So yeah. it's just our little corner. We kind of exist. I say to the people I talk to, I'm willing to get in the mud with them. That's where we are, is down in the mud with the conspiracy theorists. Of course we're outnumbered. You know, that's what we do. We take them on. Someone's got to.
Well, you know,
but we're
outnumbered
just by the people that are vocal. And how many, for instance, in the forums, how many people, when we have a program on Sandy Hook, there might be 6 or 7 in the forums that are calling us, a lot of names. There is a consensus that was built immediately after this event, within 2 or 3 days, calling it a hoax. They framed the debate for the so-called truth movement. And people have not done any homework. They have just listened to the people who framed the debate. So we can't really say, oh, yeah, we're in the minority. I don't believe we're in the minority. I don't think that truth is going to – it's not a popularity contest. It's about truth, okay?
Yeah, most definitely. And, you know, it's not really exciting information to tell someone, hey, listen, you know that shooting that happened 2 years ago? I can prove that the school existed, that these kids died in. You know, that's not really exciting, but if you have information that's really sensational and say, hey, listen, I can prove that school didn't exist 2 years ago. There's no record of it. You know, people are going to bite on that kind of information. But, I mean, I do, you know, like just like what Dave said, you know, there's a heck of a bigger audience among those who believe it's a hoax and those who are, quote unquote, debunking it. You know, I mean, we're stepping into a territory
sure.
that's completely kind of like heresy for people like you and me, Deanna, who have, spent the last few years talking about government conspiracies like, you know, JFK and USS
sure.
Liberty and 9/11 and things like that.
Cool.
And, you know, and then when you and when you're saying
it's courageous.
You know, the cops are the good and when you're saying the cops are the good guys, I mean, I don't know how many stories I've written about police brutality and how angry I've personally gotten at seeing the atrocities that are being committed today by police officers. You know, and I just, I mean, I really had did work myself up into a frenzy just thinking that, you know, it's us against them. But I mean, really, what this thing has really done, this Sandy Hook, has shown me that, you know, they're not all bad out there. You know, I believe that this is part of a divide and conquer strategy to make us think that we don't have friends among those in law enforcement, that we don't, you know, that everybody is suspect and that we can't trust each other. I mean, my God, how are we ever going to be able to organize against any type of real threat out there if we're all suspicious of one another? You know what I'm saying?
True.
I mean, there are good police officers with, you know.
I live next door to a policeman who is a terrific person. And I've lived next door to him for probably 10 years. But speaking of the school and the school board, did they ask the question, because it has been proffered by some people in the truth movement, that the school was closed for the last 5 years. Now, did anybody bother to ask that question?
Not
of the
one
school
of them.
Board?
I think Keith, you know that because you saw it. No, what they asked was, I think Fetzer asked, that, you know, where are these 600 students? It would have taken, you know, 12 buses, you know, 50 students in each bus. Why don't we have any, you know, visual evidence of that, you know, that existed?
But he didn't ask about the Wayback Machine stuff.
No, he did in his article.
Yeah. Yeah, but did they ask the school board? That would be
no, they didn't ask, and I've said from the
that's
beginning
that's probably the only thing those people might know.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. They should have. I know.
Yeah,
but they
wouldn't have. I don't think that the protocol allows them to answer. But what I've said all along is what this story is all about, really, and because they have to go by Robert's rules of order and everything, you know, parliamentary procedure.
Right.
But what this story is all about is not Wolfgang or Jim Fetzer or any of these things. What this story is all about is that how many people there are out there, and there are a lot of people out there who are willing to give money to this.
So you all could go to the foundry and have a lousy sandwich in French.
Well, now look, that was my opinion.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Other people might have liked it. All right. But here you got Tanya Graham giving $100 an hour ago. Wolfgang and everyone with you, stay strong, and we are with you in spirit. Richard O'Connor yesterday, $10. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. $20. Raymond, much revered by all. Wolfgang.
Okay,
you know, so
are these people doing any original research of their own, or are they just counting on Wolfgang to come forth with all the answers, which have already been answered?
The answer to the question is that they are looking to Wolfgang to get them the answers. But like I said, that's the story here. The story is that people will reach into their pocketbooks, and they'll lay out money because they want somebody to get the answers for them.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the answers questions have already been answered.
That doesn't matter to them. They're not going to give money to Wade. Wade's boring. Right?
Wade's true.
No,
we're
boring. Right. That's what I'm saying. Wade's boring. Well, look, Wade isn't charismatic.
Yes,
right?
He does.
Wait, he doesn't even have a catchphrase. Like Wolf has, they came into my house, now I'm going to their house. Wade needs a catchphrase.
And Wade isn't collecting any money.
Right, well, that's the whole point. And that goes back to human nature, right? And it goes back to my hopelessness.
Okay,
so,
would you say that this whole thing was a sideshow, Dave?
I don't know. I don't know.
it seems to me that it was an effort to get more people on board to say that it was a hoax. Because I think what he did, he anticipated what would happen. It happened. The fact that he would call the police, call 911 when the guy pushed him. I mean, that just proves to me that he got exactly what he went there for. And that's more support, and he's going to be getting more money.
Dave, we got
That's a possibility. That's a possibility. Yeah.
We got 2 days right now. We got, it was like $15,000. And the only thing they posted was that at the library, there's no elementary school yearbooks. Day two. That's what we got. I would not be happy for my $10, you're the best Wolfgang, if that's all I got is that there's no... There are none for none of the schools. I don't even know, do they keep yearbooks at the library for elementary schools? I don't know.
You can get them online.
But that's what
I don't think these people care. You know, I think they just, again, it's the whole thing of, you know, hey, we like the way this guy sounds. He looks good. He's got the catchphrase. He doesn't believe it. He thinks they're conning us. Let's give him some money and let him find out, you know, whether it's 10, 5, 100, 200, 500. I've seen all those numbers. They don't care. They're gonna give it to him. And there's people who believe in him. And there's people who don't believe in him.
Yeah, and they don't care. And they do not care about looking for themselves to verify that whatever Halbig is saying is true. For instance, Halbig put a tombstone, a picture of a tombstone that said Adam Patrick Lanza, and then it had a bunch of misspelling on it. And he says, look at this tombstone. He says, it shows the date that he died a day earlier than the event actually happened. He says, how could a father allow this to happen? You know, I'm paraphrasing all this stuff. And then Wade found out that tombstone is, you could, it's a, there's a, there's a, I mean, there's a website you can go to. It's called Tombstone Generator, where it has a blank tombstone. It's the exact same tombstone with the exact shadowing, the exact kind of wear and tear on the tombstone, and you can put anything you want on it. Yeah, so you have
to take
that down.
And Patrick wasn't even his name.
Yeah, it wasn't even his middle. Yeah, he fell for this thinking that was actually Adam Lanza. And then another thing he did, like today or yesterday, he says, he shows a blurry picture of a desk purportedly to be Sarah Cox's, and it's enclosed, and he says, how could she possibly have seen him from the legs down, because this desk is enclosed? It's impossible for her to have seen it. But then you read her testimony, and she said that there's a small hole in the desk where wires run out of the desk into the computers, and that's where she looked, and in this, which you wouldn't see on this blurry photograph. So, I mean, he's just a wealth of disinformation, and you will never, and all you see is the comments going, good work, Halbig, good work, Wolfgang. Nobody double checks his work. They just pat him on the back and go to his GoFundMe and give him another 10, 20, 100 bucks, whatever it is. It's just, I mean, it's just a sad state of affairs how easily duped people can be. It really is.
We're dumbed down. We're a dumbed down nation.
He's caused Newtown to circle the wagons. He's not getting anywhere in Newtown. That is a group of people that has circled the wagons. I can't imagine they would. They probably will only do as much as the law requires them to do. It's probably all he will ever get out of them. He's not going to be able to use his experience and his past and all of his connections that maybe he's developed over his years and doing whatever he's done. None of that's going to matter to them people.
To show this was a publicity stunt. I mean, if he was smart, I mean, because he even said on one post, he says, I can't get anywhere. Every time I introduce myself as Wolfgang Halbig, it's a dead end. They won't talk to me. So what he could have done if he was smart is get a professional private investigator in Connecticut who knows how to handle people and get information. It doesn't have a reputation like him, but no. He had to do everything himself. He wanted to spend however much money it was, $10,000, to fly everybody out there, hoping to get arrested. I mean, I really, truly believe that he really is disappointed that they didn't haul him out there in handcuffs so he can call himself a martyr and say, oh, my First Amendment rights were violated, and, you know, please feel sorry for me and donate more money. You know, that's what he really wanted, and it didn't turn out that way.
Dave, you're out there. Why did a Florida guy hire a Nevada attorney to fly out to Connecticut? Do you know? I mean, did you ask him that?
No, I don't know, and I think it might have had to do with the fact that he reached out to him. See, Wolfgang has attracted a lot of attention by people. I think that he might have reached out to Wolfgang, and Wolfgang is viewed as like a cult figure.
Mm-hmm.
So there are, you know, there, like that guy Biondi or however you say it, he wanted to take I was standing there, he asked Wolfgang if he could take a picture with him, because it was funny, because I had seen this guy, someone was saying, this guy Dan Biondi's there, and I'm like, you know, who is he, you know, because I'm so dumb, I don't know, you know, I really don't know any of these people, because I don't watch anything, and he's this guy, and then I looked at him, I said, oh, hey, and I recognized, you know, his face. And then I said, oh, yeah, you were the guy who's, he's like, yeah. He says, you want to take a picture? And then I was like, yeah, sure. And so I went to take a picture of him. He goes, no, I meant, did you want to take a picture with me? And I was like, no, I don't.
Not really.
Yeah, no, why would I? I don't understand. Why would I want to take a picture with you? You know, but I guess he assumed that I would, you know, like, I'm like a follower of his or something. But then, like I said, at the end of the thing, he wanted to take a picture with Wolfgang, and then a bunch of
you
them lined up with.
Hold on to your wallet.
I'm sorry.
Hang on to your wallet. What do you do?
Yeah, I don't have a wallet, which is a good thing. But I mean, it was, I didn't get in any pictures with anybody myself. I took a lot of pictures for the paper, but I didn't. I don't think I got a picture with Wolfgang or Fetzer or certainly not Biondi. But it was interesting. I don't know though, Wade, why it is that this particular, I can find out. It's easy to find out.
Yeah,
this particular attorney.
Ambulance chasing almost, because he got paid. He's not there free. He got like $6,000 from Halbig or something. Halbig posted the amount he paid that guy. It's a lot. It's $5,000 or $6,000. I don't know how much.
Yeah,
he got
yeah, you're funny. I heard $5,000, and I got paid $6,000. Insult Biondi. Yeah.
$1,000, I'd have gone.
There was a bidding war for me to come out here, so I took the $6,000. They said, just smack Biondi around a little bit, and we'll give you $6,000. I said, no problem. Who is he? Point him out to me. So, now, that was, I don't know why. I don't know why he would, you know, he would get paid $5,000 if that's the actual figure. You know, I don't know what he actually did for that $5,000. Like I said, I'm sure I could find out, but
I don't know either.
And I don't know how much the whole trip cost.
And a couple
who's
of them,
guy?
Like Biondi. Yeah, a couple of them said they didn't even question that it was a hoax. Like Biondi, he said right up. He says, "Oh yeah, well, you know, Adam Lanza cased the schools. You know, he pretty much supported the official story." So he was a little, isn't that what you gathered from that, Wade, as well, that, he was pretty much supporting it? He just got there and gave a lecture on gun control. That's basically all he did.
Yeah, I don't like his lecture. I've always been into, as a gun control, I don't like what he said at all. I don't want him speaking for me at all as a gun owner, but
they might use
some
it for
of them
anti for
Oriel, I'm sorry. You know, they seem to play it. To me, I thought they were playing it off. I don't think they believed the thing, but they wanted to say the words for whatever reason. Some were honest. You know, at least Thomas Lapp was honest. He, you know, straight up called it, you know, to their face that he didn't believe it. But I think Biondi tried to play it off. I don't really know how to say his name. He tried to play it off.
Well, it was, I'm sure it was very interesting. I don't think that, as I said before, that Halbig and Fetzer accomplished anything. It's apparently a sideshow. And if that's what they wanted to accomplish, then it was a big success. And if they are thinking that it was successful, then you know exactly what their objectives were. It was not to go out there to get answers to their questions. It was to do exactly what they did. To not get answers.
To hurt people.
Yeah, that's a possibility.
Just a little bit of empathy is what I'd say here. You know, if you even entertain the possibility, I know you guys know there was children killed that day, and I don't really know where Dave, maybe Dave's like on the fence, or I don't really know what Dave thinks.
Well, Dave doesn't have an opinion.
Okay, so,
well,
so if you entertain the idea, a little bit of empathy for these people who absolutely, you know that it happened, then, and know the people that died, then I would say that it was a spectacle. I would call it a spectacle. It was a disgrace.
Sure.
Your group now, when you see these parades of the you know, God hates gays people and these type of people like that, that's his peer group as far as I'm concerned. So that's where
Danbury News Times.com has already covered the story. It's already posted, and it's got Halbig's picture and everything.
You got a link?
Yeah, it's called Newtown School Board Greets Sandy Hook Skeptics with Silence. Yeah, News Time. Well, if you just go
I'm gonna do
it. Okay.
Newtown School Board Greets.
Yeah.
Let's see. Yeah, there it is.
Sandy
Wow,
Hook.
Thank you,
yeah.
Keith.
Yeah, there's you are. I could see you,
That's
too.
Great.
You're in the background right there. Yeah, you're right there over his shoulder.
I gotta look at this here.
We're getting some disruption in Skype a little bit here. I don't know if you guys hear it, but. Right. I'm in the picture.
They came and they spoke. Look at this. I love the first paragraph. They came and they spoke, but their words fell flat with a respectful but thoroughly disgusted audience.
Wow.
Oh, they're terrible. This is a real big, oh, boy. Yeah, they're going to tear into these people.
Yeah, there's a bunch of pictures. There's actually 19 pictures.
Wow. Mm. Yeah, you're right.
Oh, 19?
Okay.
Huh? Well, yeah, they wouldn't cover this story. They wouldn't cover this story unless they meant to discredit these people. They wouldn't. Every story you see is going to just make them out to be complete buffoon idiots. They just really cut their own throats.
But how did that follow the Barnum and Bailey or whoever said it? You know, as long as you spell my name right, I don't really care what you say. So, you
know. Media whore. He's a media whore. I mean, he's such a media whore.
Good find
Good
find.
Yeah, I just looked it up. I've been doing that because I figured if, like you said, if there was a bunch of reporters around, that they'd be covering it soon.
Sure.
Boy, they really pumped this article out in just a matter of an hour. Quite a few paragraphs here.
Police were there.
Yeah.
How many police were there, Dave?
The police there. There were just maybe two or three, you know,
none
police. The Danbury police. No. Oh, yeah. There is something I forgot to mention. They were speculating that one of the Newtown cops who came to the station when Wolfgang made that 911 call to press charges against his fireman, that who came there was also in the Boston Marathon bombing, that he was dressed up in khaki, and they actually even asked him that question, and he, you know, they said, "Are you the same guy?" And he didn't answer them. He said, "Yeah, that's funny, huh? You know, that I guess that he looked like that guy." But they are speculating that Newtown cop was also one of the people in the Boston Marathon bomb.
Speculating is a very good choice of words.
Oh, Deanna, they have your information in here too. They talk about the United Way, and they said Chief Executive Officer Kim Morgan said the group was told that all financial documents for the nonprofit agency can be found online.
I published that too. I told them that.
I can't remember if you told me or Deanna. I can't remember.
Yeah, it was me. I don't know.
That was you. Okay.
But I definitely.
That was right. Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Yeah, you did tell me. Yeah, you did tell me. Wait, yeah. Now that I remember. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, there's James Fetzer. Yeah. Gosh.
I mean, what does the University of Duluth have to say about Fetzer? I mean.
Oh, gentlemen, we're running out of time.
Nope.
Excuse me. Well, it has been very interesting, and I thank you, Dave, for doing this report, giving us the scoop on everything that they found out. And that no questions were asked or answered there because, of course, they've already been answered thanks to people who have actually done some real research. So thank you, gentlemen, who called in. I really appreciate it, Keith and Wade.
Thank you.
And Dave, and thanks to the listeners. So I'll talk to you soon.
Bye.
Thank
Take
you.
Care.
Sure. Thanks, Deanna. Good talking to all of you.
Yes, thank you all. Bye-bye.